Buenas, ¿cómo andan? Bueno, les doy la bienvenida a esta segunda charla del día de hoy, de este día de neurociencias dentro de la semana de divulgación científica que estamos llevando adelante desde Neurotransmitiendo, junto con MEP y la ACP. Mi nombre es Tomás D'Amelio. Yo formo parte de Neurotransmitiendo y hoy tengo el honor, el agrado de presentar a Stefano Palminteri. Stefano es doctor en neurociencias cognitivas por la Universidad Pierre Marie Curie. Hizo algunos postdocs en la École Normale Supérieure, también en la Universidad de Trento y en la University College London. Y actualmente es director del grupo de Human Reinforcement Learning, que es aprendizaje por refuerzos en humanos, que forma parte del laboratorio de neurociencias cognitivas y computacionales pertenecientes al INSERM y a la École Normale Supérieure en París. Dentro de los intereses de Stefano se encuentra principalmente la comprensión acerca de cómo los humanos aprenden a tomar decisiones a nivel conductual, computacional y neuronal. Espero que pueda hablar un poquito de eso hoy. Y menciona que también le gusta tratar algunos temas epistemológicos y metodológicos sobre investigación en tomas de decisiones y neuroeconomía. Y por último, Stefano fue docente mío el semestre pasado en la asignatura de neuroeconomía, en el máster de Ciencias Cognitivas de la École Normale Supérieure, así que también es docente en dicho máster. Bueno, como saben, esta va a ser la única charla de este ciclo, de esta semana que estamos organizando, que va a ser completamente en inglés, ¿sí? Y como saben que somos pobres, no podemos tener traducción simultánea, pero lo que proponemos es lo siguiente. Ahora yo voy a pasar a presentar a Stefano en inglés, ¿sí? La charla va a ser en inglés y después vamos a tener un espacio de preguntas y respuestas. Idealmente sería bueno que las preguntas fueran en inglés, así no me dan doble trabajo porque mi inglés no es fantástico, pero si estuvieran en castellano también puedo hacer ese trabajito de traducirlas. Aprovecho para decir de la importancia de aprender inglés en caso que estén interesados en meterse en investigación en psicología y neurociencias, es muy importante. A mí me costó muchísimo. Pero vale la pena en caso que les interese seguir por este rumbo. O sea que paso a switch de idioma. Okay, so welcome to today's second talk in this Neuroscience Day during the Science Dissemination Week. My name is Tomás D'Amelio, and today I'm pleased to introduce Stefano Palminteri, who was my professor last semester in a neuroeconomic course at the École Normale Supérieure. Stefano holds a PhD in cognitive neuroscience from the Université Pierre and Marie Curie, with postdocs at the École Normale Supérieure, the University of Trento, and the University College London. And he's currently head of the Human Reinforcement Learning Team, which is part of the Laboratory of Computational Cognitive Neuroscience. I don't know how to say that in French. At the INSERM and the École Normale Supérieure. And his goal is understanding how humans learn to make decisions at the behavioral, computational, and neural levels. And in his spare time, he says that he enjoys questioning the epistemological and methodological foundations of decision-making, research, and neuroeconomics. So welcome to this Science Dissemination Week, Stefano. Can you hear me? Yes.
Thank you, Thomas. Thank you very much for the invitation. So first of all, I want to say I think I should be lo siento, no hablo bien español. So I will be delivering my speech in English. And yeah, I want to thank you for the invitation, but also praise you for the organizing this important workshop. And to help the community raise awareness on the importance of quantitative and empirical methods in psychology. So I will start by sharing my screen. And I will ask you to confirm that you can see my screen just fine.
Yes, we can.
Is it okay? Okay, the slides now are full screen.
Yes.
All right, so perfect. So today I'm going to talk about learning from trial and error. We will see during the presentation exactly what cognitive process I'm referring to by this idiom, essentially, learning by trial and error. And we will try to have like a a quick exposition of different insights coming from different fields, psychology, artificial intelligence, and neuroscience. And so this is the plan of the presentation. We will start by psychology. So it's the beginning, the starting point. And then we will describe a little bit more what artificial intelligence can has actually delivered to our field. We'll move then to neuroscience. And finally, I will conclude by describing very briefly a couple of findings from my own lab to illustrate a little bit what are the current questions that we ask in the field. Okay, so let's start with the psychological aspects. Okay, so let me start by just highlighting briefly when we talk about learning by trial and error, what are really the historical roots of the scientific empirical investigation of this question. And essentially the answer is that this scientific endeavor is as old as scientific psychology per se, okay? So the investigation of trial and error learning dates back from actually even before the behaviorist period. So you may have also heard about, of course, by Ivan Pavlov or Thorndike, which were actually considered hero by the behaviorist psychologists, but they did not consider themselves a behaviorist. They were before this phase in the development of the field. And then of course, Watson, Skinner, et cetera, et cetera. Scientifically speaking, learning by trial and error has a different name, is sometimes called conditioning, especially in this literature, in this original literature, sometimes called associative learning a little bit later, even today, and is also called reinforcement learning, which is the term that I will be using more today, okay? So we shall start by defining what is reinforcement learning, okay? So before actually saying what is reinforcement learning, let's clarify what is not reinforcement learning, because the repertoire of the learning behavior is quite big, okay? So reinforcement learning is not innate behavior, okay? So it's not something that has been hard coded in your gene to be expressed. So this is the definition of something that is innate. It doesn't require experience by definition. It's not other form of learning such as habituation and sensitization, okay? So these are form of learning that occurs, for example, when you are presented several times with the same stimulus, you will develop a sort of sensitization, you will react faster to the stimulus, but this is not reinforcement learning. And it's not social learning, okay? So we learn by observing other subjects, by imitation, et cetera, or from teaching. Again, this is not what is defined reinforcement learning. What actually is reinforcement learning is learning association between the stimuli or situation, sometimes we can say context, and a particular kind of stimuli that are rewards and punishments. So essentially stimuli that have an affective charge, an affective valence. Learn this association how? By being exposed in the past by this association. And the idea is that this learned association result in an observable and quantifiable modification of the behavior of the learner, okay? So let's overview what are the traditional form of reinforcement learning that are investigated in the literature. And let's start with the typical example of classical or Pavlovian conditioning, okay? So this is the famous experiment by Ivan Pavlov. He was actually studying the gastric function of these animals, and the experimental preparation, how it is called, or the setup was very simple. So essentially we have an animal, we are recording the salivation of the animal. And first the animal is presented to just a sound in absence of food. And of course the sound elicit no response, no salivation, because this sound, for example, a bell ringing, has no affective valence for the animal. Then we have a learning or association phase in which the sound is now systematically paired with a food, okay? And in this case, we observe salivation, but this is normal because the food naturally induces salivation, Okay. Also, something that is important to understand is that in the case of classical or Pavlova conditioning, the response that we observe are innate physiological response that are naturally linked to the reward at stake. So in that case, it's food and the response is salivation. And what Pavlov observed is that after repeated exposure of this association between sound and food, the sound per se was capable to actually elicit a salivation even in the absence of any food. Okay, so the animal was told to have developed an association between a stimulus and a reward. Okay. Now, one of the most important research questions in the history of reinforcement learning has been to establish what are the conditions that actually promote the development of this learning process. Okay. And there has been at least three important conditions that has been identified as necessary and sufficient to develop learning in this context. Okay. First one is the idea of a temporal contiguity between the stimulus and the reward. Okay. So in other terms, the sound has to be close enough to the reward in order to develop an association. So if you ring the bell one day before you deliver the reward, no association is gonna be learned because too much time elapsed. So probably you may say the memory trace of the stimulus disappear, etc. The second condition that is necessary is that what is called contingency. So there should be a certain predictive value in the stimulus, okay? If the best contingency to understand this is that there is a 100% correlation between the stimulus and the reward, right? So if every time that there is a sound, there is a reward, you will totally see why there is a stronger association compared to a situation in which when there is a sound, there are only 80% of the time a delivery of a reward. So we degraded the contingency, the association is weaker. And the third point, which is a little bit less intuitive, but nonetheless important, and we will actually see how this can be formalized into mathematical models of conditioning, is the idea that there should be the reward when it is delivered, it should be surprising to some extent. So in other terms, you may not be able to already predict the occurrence of the reward based on other stimuli in a given context, okay? And the folk psychology intuition behind this idea is that essentially learning is a function of the surprise. So when you are surprised by some results, it's a good sign that you have to revise, to modify your belief in order to understand, to predict better the world the next time you're exposed with the same situation. So of course, Pavlovian conditioning is just the starting point. Reinforcement learning is much more complex, and probably the more interesting part is what is called instrumental, or in Skinner words, operant conditioning or operant learning. The associative structure here is more complex because we have a stimulus and a reward, so as in Pavlovian conditioning, but this association between a stimulus and a reward is now mediated by the animal or the subject or the human performing an action, okay? So the reward is contingent not only on a stimulus, but also on an action. While in the Pavlovian, the animal is or the subject is completely passive. There is just two stimuli that are one after the other. Thorndike, for example, invented the puzzle box. There is a cat closed in a box. He can pull a string to get out and get some food outside. And for example, he observed, and what it was formalized, what is called the law of effect, that after several trials, the time needed for the animal escaping was significantly reduced, okay? And you can see here a typical learning curve, which has this basic property. So we start with a initial performance, then there is an increase of performance, in this case, a decrease of reaction times with a negative acceleration, meaning that the change over time become smaller and smaller until the curve reach a plateau of maximum response. So in this case, for example, 2 seconds is the as speed as the animal can go in this situation, This is another typical experiment that is used to investigate instrumental learning. It is called a T-maze or a Y-maze because of the shape of the maze. So essentially it's a micro labyrinth. The animal is put in one arm of this labyrinth and has to learn going left or right. In this case, for example, the reward is put, for example, always on the right. And again, you can observe here a learning curve in which essentially the probability of choosing the right arm, which is the rewarded arm, increase over time. Startup chance level, of course, a random level, 50% increase until it reaches a plateau. You can also see the difference compared to Pavlovian learning is that while Pavlovian learning, the response are usually innate response or something which is automatic like salivation. In this case, the response is motor response, something which is observable and involves muscle and movements, etc. I mean, also salivation is observable, but in this case, it involves some sort of like voluntary action. I showed you example of reinforcement learning paradigms that involves positive reinforcement, typically food or something like that. But of course, there are also the negative side of reward is punishment. You can have somehow similar effects if essentially the stake or the incentive is not positive, but is negative. And you can have similar experimental setup to investigate this situation, for example, in animal. This would be a classical fear conditioning paradigm in which there is a sound that is now associated to electric shock, and we can measure the behavior of the animal, typically what is called a freezing response, a fear response. So the animal freeze, doesn't move, waiting for the shock. You can have also negative or punishment or negative rewards in an instrumental context. So for example, this is what is called the shuttle box invented by Maurer, another behaviorist. The idea is there are two different compartments. The animal can go from one compartment to the other one, and the floor is also electrified, like in the Pavlovian case. And whenever there is a sound, there is a shock that's gonna be delivered in a given compartment and the animal learn to jump on the other side, okay? We will actually, so if we can start summarizing this fundamental axis or fundamental aspect of reinforcement learning, one important organization of reinforcement learning behavior is first, whether the reinforcement is positive reward of negative punishment. So what is called the balance of the learning problem, of the learning process. Also another important axis is whether essentially the response, the behavioral response involves doing something or not doing something. So an activation or an inhibition. And as a matter of fact, here I put this shaded area between this diagonal of this Cartesian axis to illustrate the idea is that in general, reward learning facilitate the acquisition of positive response of motor activation, while punishment situation, the learning of response omission is somehow facilitated. And this is why, this is probably because there is an ecological, primordial link between, of course, to get a reward, you have to do something, right? You will not just sit in your cave and having food coming to your mouth. You have to do something to achieve a reward. While concerning avoiding punishment, often the good strategy to avoid punishment is just don't do nothing, just be hidden, etc. Another important feature of our research question and feature of reinforcement learning processes is whether or not the behavioral response is actually actively controlled it's controlled or essentially is automatic, okay? As a matter of fact, there is a lot of complex behavior that we optimize, we fine tune by repetition, trial and error, success and failure, which after several repetition becomes what we call habits, okay? And it's very different from what they called habituation at the beginning. Unfortunately, this is a terminological overlap, but habit in the context of reinforcement learning is not just the fact that you reduce your response as a function of exposure, but rather the fact that you essentially learn and at some point even overlearn one task until it becomes completely automatic. And the classical example is that what typically happens with routines, okay? So you have you wake up and then in an almost automatic state, you wake up, you brush your teeth, you do your coffee, you take the metro or the scooter or the velo. I mean, this is before COVID, right? But we will get again to this situation soon enough. And you essentially do that, not really thinking about, okay, so to open the coffee machine, I have to do that. So you are not planning, right? It's not like a controlled process, an automatic process. And you can see that the habit formation has a very strong adaptive value that essentially allows you to perform things that are quite complex in an automatic way and free your mental space for thinking different things. So for example, this morning I was able to go to the lab in a completely automatic way. And while I was going to the lab, I was able to think about the lecture that I was going to deliver to you. And it was a very good thing. Essentially, this is just to summarize. I will illustrate this slide. So there is another fundamental axis in reinforcement learning, is the one of the control, or whether the action is actually automatic or controlled. And I already illustrated what are the pros of that, the fact that you can optimize, increase efficiency, free mental space to develop to realize complex tasks. But the counter side of that is that essentially when the control is the habits can be sometimes associated to maladaptive behavior. So for example, there are theories that suppose that anxiety and phobias or addiction are too much of a habit development, either in the negative or in the positive domain, okay? So this is to summarize the insights from psychology. So we have different forms of reinforcement learning, Pavlovian with a simple associative structure between state or stimuli and reward, and instrumental control and instrumental behavior, which essentially the outcome is mediated by an action. And within instrumental behavior, we have two phases, a controlled or goal-directed phase in which the subject is essentially representing all the different steps in a sort of explicit manner. And after practice, we make a transition to an habit situation in which essentially the action is just automatically induced by the stimuli without really thinking about, what is gonna happen or the different sub goals that you want to achieve, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, now let's move to insights from the artificial intelligence part. And let's first, again, as we've done before, start defining what is reinforcement learning by defining what is not reinforcement learning in machine learning, okay? I just specified for dummies by a dummy, because first of all, I'm not an artificial research intelligence, intelligence researcher myself. So I learned something for reinforcement learning because it is useful for my research. And I will also oversimplify things. But anyway, useful simplification between different categories of machine learning. There are three forms of machine learning: unsupervised, supervised, and reinforcement learning. Okay, to do what? So I will pick an example of everybody's familiar with. It's the idea, for example, facial recognition is something that every phone can do. You can put yourself or Facebook or whatever can recognize faces, okay? And I will illustrate a little bit how different algorithms will do that. And by the way, this is typically a task that is very poorly done by reinforcement learning algorithm. So other tasks are better done by reinforcement learning algorithm, okay? So unsupervised learning, the idea of the model is essentially to look for statistical regularities and create unlabeled categories or cluster of data. So it is presented, for example, with different picture, and we'll analyze the pixel of the picture, how they organize, whether or not there is cross correlation, etc. And you feed it with a lot of data, and there are different dimensions. And then, for example, it's gonna be able to create two different clusters. And yeah, for example, with the human faces versus dog, with the results will look something like that. And probably there will be human faces that are really representative. I don't know, Natalie Portman or the other guy. Dogs that are really dogs, so typical, I don't know, collie or some classical dogs. And then from some borderline situation, the picture will be classified a little bit less well. So for example, a gorilla will be in between, a pug, which is a weird dog also, the wolf, the table, the painting, something like that, okay? This is one strategy. Just look at the data and see what are the main dimensions of the data and make essentially a classification based on that. Supervised learning is different because in this case, the model or the algorithm receive from a teacher, okay, labeled example. So first, and then try to generalize, okay? So the idea is that typically in this supervised learning, you devise your stimuli into a training set and a test set. And in the training, there is the, you know, omniscient teacher that say, okay, this is a human, this is a dog. And then they're gonna test the performance of the algorithm in new stimuli to optimize precisely this detection and this generalization process. That typically you will get some percentage of how much the model thinks it's a human or it's a dog, etc. Okay, so this is yet another strategy that can be used. So there is a learning process, but the learning process is dependent on essentially a teacher, so an external force that provide already data that whose value is known. And then there is the reinforcement learning strategy, in which the idea is a little bit different. There is a teaching signal, but the teaching signal doesn't come from a teacher, but from the environment, okay? So the teaching signal is the feedback, is essentially whether the algorithm was correct or not. And the typical idea is that there is an interaction, a repeated interaction with the environment, and the capacity to, essentially do several rounds of optimization, essentially. Exactly. So reinforcement learning is an interaction with the environment. The agent produces an action, the environment produces a new state and a reward. And based on this new information, which are stored in memory, there is a reaction the next time. So for example, in this first trial, the model is given a positive feedback for saying human for Natalie Portman and a negative feedback for the pug. And then you can see that this negative feedback is correct in the subsequent trial. As I said, reinforcement learning is a very bad algorithm for facial recognition, but there are other situations in which it is used. And here I will just deliver a little bit of very intuitive maths, really very simple, to illustrate what is essentially the main reinforcement learning model that is used in the field, in my lab, but also in the other labs, which is, I will show a very simplified version that derives essentially equally from artificial intelligence, but also psychology research, where we are modeling the instrumental learning case, okay? So here the agent is trying to choosing among two options, A and B. And the first rule is that the agent decide between A and B as a function of the difference of the value between A and B, okay? So you can see it's very simple. When the value of A is bigger than B, we are in this part of the graph. So the agent tends to choose A more than B. When the difference is zero, the agent is indifferent. And when the B is better than A, the learner, the agent, choose A more, okay? Okay, suppose that we have chosen A, now we get a reward, okay? Following this action. We can now calculate a prediction error. This is to be connected with the surprise that I discussed before. And this prediction error is essentially a surprise we design because it's the difference between the obtained reward and the expected reward. So for example, I was thinking that the value of A is point is zero and I get one, so I have a positive surprise, right? Because I was thinking it was zero. Or for example, if I was thinking that the reward of A, of the value of A is 25 and I get one, so the same outcome, in this case, it would be a negative surprise. And typically, so in a simplified case in which the true value of A is always one, what we observe that you have big prediction error at the beginning, you have a bigger surprise at the beginning of learning, and then when you learn the value, essentially is an error correction model, the prediction error decrease. So once you have calculated this prediction error, you can now move to the update or learning rule in which you simply say that the value of A at the trial T plus one, so the subsequent one of time that you observe A, is a function of the previous belief about what was the value of A plus the prediction error multiplied by a learning rate. Now you can see that this learning rate alpha is zero, there is no learning. So essentially the value at T plus one is always equal to the value of T, right? So the higher the learning rate, the faster you learn the value of something, okay? And then progressively you converge to the true value. So there are several roles actually for reinforcement learning algorithms, which are, by the way, in real life applications, sometimes often associated with unsupervised and supervised system. And really, essentially it's super vast, the domain of application in technology, from robotics to finance. So you can use, we even work on this topic a little bit, but you can use reinforcement learning algorithms to predict the evolution of financial markets, of course, robots. A lot of artificial intelligence research involves reinforcement learning, and one of the preferred things that that in AI research they want to do is to play in games. For example, AlphaStar or AlphaGo, that are algorithms that are very performing in actually solving games, involve reinforcement learning parts, etc. And there is also application in neuroscience. We will see in a second some results that comes from the application of reinforcement learning algorithms to neuroscience as analytical instruments to essentially quantify behavioral and neural data, and also interpretational instruments. So you can observe our results and then you can compare the results to the theoretical prediction and make an interpretation of whether or not a model has been implemented, okay? So let's move to insight from neuroscience. I suppose you already have these parts, so a very short introduction to neuroanatomy. There are different parts in the brain, right? So the cortex in the most external part on the top, this is what is called a sagittal slide. It's profile essentially. You have the cortex, you have also the cerebellum, not super involved in reinforcement learning, and then you have a brain stem, which is a little bit evolutionary hold. So this is another way of looking at the brain sliced now. It's a coronal slide, so in the face. And interestingly for us, you have not only the cortex, but also subcortical parts. And we will see these parts are especially important of the brain in reinforcement learning. So this is a very short introduction concerning neuroanatomy. And an equally short introduction concerning neurochemistry is we have different kinds of molecules that operate the function of the brain, neurotransmitters, so essentially glutamate, GABA, which are very fast, are essentially delivered to just the daily connection, the daily communication between two different neurons. They are released very, very fast and they have very short-term effects, are very localized, essentially the single neuron. Then you have neuromodulators that are a little bit slower and with effects that are more at the population level. And this involves something that we will discuss a little bit more later. It's essentially dopamine, but also serotonin. So you have a lot of, in both cases, you have a lot of psychiatric medication that actually act on this system. And we will see for reinforcement learning, very important is the neuromodulator dopamine, which is also popularly called the neuromodulator of pleasure, of reward, etc. And we'll see why. And finally, you have also another class of molecules that we are not going to discuss either, which is neurohormones. They have a slow release and very long-term effect, such as opioids, oxytocin, et cetera. Again, different class of medication affect these molecular systems, but not super relevant immediately for reinforcement learning. Okay, so the first question, if you want to investigate the neuroscience of reinforcement learning, is how do we proceed to essentially identify a neural system of reward, a reward system in the brain, okay? And I will give you an historical slash step-by-step conceptual way to demonstrate it. So we start with a fundamental setup, which is the Skinner box, okay? The Skinner box is an animal put in a chamber, and there's different stimuli, colors, sound, and can press on a lever, on two different levers, in order to deliver some sort of response, okay? First, we're gonna start by these definitions that in the context of instrumental learning, okay, or operant conditioning, a reward is something, or literally anything, that is capable to increase a response rate of an animal, okay? So a reward, for example, is food, because if pressing the lever gives you food, you will see that pressing is gonna increase in frequency. Water with sugar is also a reward because it's gonna increase pressing the lever. But for example, if you put a night puff, so something that actually give like a night puff in the face, it's gonna induce a decrease in the frequency of lever pressing because night puff is actually a punishment. It's not very cool. Or you can have totally neutral things like a sound. For example, a sound is neutral. If lever pressing is associated to a sound, there is no way that this sound is gonna increase or decrease pressing the lever, okay? Now, replace these things, food, air, air path, light, with essentially a direct electric stimulation of the brain. So we are modifying a little bit this Skinner box, such as pressing the lever now corresponds to a direct electric stimulation of different parts of the brain, okay? And now we will actually move the electrodes in different parts of the brain. And what we are gonna see, what we are gonna look for is for places that essentially, when they are stimulated, increase lever pressing. So essentially we are gonna define operationally the reward system in the brains as the set of brain areas whose electric stimulation increases the rate of response delivering the stimulation itself, okay? So if a brain is a part of the brain is associated to a reward, the stimulation is gonna induce an increase of lever pressing. If a part of the brain is associated with no reward or even punishment, we will observe the opposite. And essentially, there are several areas, but really the most robust set of areas across experimental setup, but also across different species, is precisely this dopamine circuit. So the neurons originate in the deepest, in the oldest part of the brain and send projection to different parts, subcortical and cortical. Cortical part in the prefrontal cortex, subcortical part in the striatum. Let's have also a very short introduction concerning the methods, since I would like to illustrate you a couple of results in both electrophysiology and neuroimaging. Electrophysiology typically is used in animals. The setup is that we can have this sort of Skinner box in the animal or can be also monkey while we record neural activity. What we measure here is really activity of one single microscopic neuron, action potentials they are called. And the typical output is this scatter plot in which each point essentially consists in one spike of activity by one neuron. You can have different situation, for example, in two cases, you can have two different neural activities or in two different areas, you can have also different neural activities. In humans, we cannot put electrodes in the brain, at least in most situations, but likely we develop techniques that are called non-invasive, so we can measure, but I guess Jacobo Sitt very well explained the idea. You can measure indirectly neural activity by measuring the blood oxygenation in an area. And the idea is that the more you use an area, the more blood it requires. We can detect this with fMRI. Okay. So one of the fundamental results in neuroscience, and I think in the whole field of contemporary neuroscience, is the discovery that dopamine activity strongly correlates with learning signal in instrumental conditioning. and precisely with the prediction error. So this is a very famous slide from a very famous study in which it is shown that there are in different phase of the Pavlovian task, the dopamine activity at the moment of the reward corresponds to a reward prediction error. The first case is that there is a reward, but the reward is not predicted. You have a positive response. Then there is a reward, but the reward is predicted by a stimulus. And you can see that the response is flat here, right? And then the second case, in the last case, you predict the animal predict a reward, but we don't give the reward. And in this case, there is a depression of the activity. So you can see that there are no match points here. And these three parts correspond to positive, neutral, and negative prediction error. And this has been also replicated in humans. So I will put an example from one of my own study. How do you transform first this task into human equivalence? It's from maze to slot machine. So you essentially replace the two arms of the maze with food, with two abstract stimuli associated with different probability of rewards. Okay, like you can figure like two different slot machine. The subject doesn't know which one is correct. So in this case, it is one because this one is mostly rewarded, but you can see that the subject converge to choose the most rewarding one significantly. And when we look at neural activity in this task, what you observe, so this is the actually a trial how it unfolds. You have first a fixation, a pose, then you have the presentation of the stimuli, then you choose, and then you have an outcome. And activity in the outcome time in the ventral striatum, which is part of this dopamine circuit that I showed you before, correlates with the reward prediction errors. An interesting question that I was much interested in is also whether or not the representation of reward punishment is different. We had the same task, but this time you can see that the goal is to minimize punishment because it's not a probability of gains, a probability of loss. So here the correct response is this one, even this negative is the correct response. And in this case, you can find that there is significant activity in another area, not the striatum, but the anterior insula, which suggested us the idea that there are dissociable systems for reward and punishment. We wanted to further probe this hypothesis by complementing these imaging results with some brain lesion results. And why? Because be aware, and do not forget that essentially what fMRI is measuring is a correlation between a variable and a neural activity, but correlation do not imply causation. So this is a funny example. If you see, for example, the films by Nicolas Cage and Dying by Drawing, there is a significant correlation, but of course there is no true relation between the two things. But more seriously, the problem is this one, is that in general, when we look at activation, we immediately infer that there is a causal link between the activity in this area and the behavior. But as a matter of fact, there may be other causal structure that explain the same behavior. So the way to assess causality is essentially to test the effect of lesion in this area. I had a methodological introduction about the history of lesion approach that I will skip, and I will move directly on our case. So what we have done is that we tested patients with the lesion in the insula as a target group and lesion everywhere else in the brain in the task that I illustrated you with both a reward and a punishment counterpart. And we were able to show that the patients with the insula lesions displayed a specific deficit in the punishment domain, thus suggesting that there is a real dissociation between the two learning systems. And an interesting thing to note at this stage is that, so first of all, the cleaner and the easiest way to work in reinforcement learning is to work with money, especially if you want to compare reward and punishment. First of all, because they have the same perceptual property, plus and minus. And also because in real society, we work a lot for money. But as a matter of fact, when you compare the neural correlates of a lot of different rewards and punishments, for example, losing money, physical effort, pain, you can see that, for example, the insula encodes all kinds of punishments. Similarly, the striatum correlates with money, food, sexual stimuli, etc. So this is important because show us there is what is called a domain general reward and punishment system. So there are two different systems for reward and punishment, but there are domain general, okay? And this is also important because can start suggesting us why sometimes we behave irrationally. And the idea, which is essentially taken from me by Diane and Cohen for language, is that the idea that essentially we are recycling old, evolutionary old areas that are evolved to solve this kind of foraging problem to solve modern problems. So now you can see that, for example, hunting is very different to what is happening today, okay? So for example, the fact that we treat reward and punishment in area that had original development to develop the two very different rewards may explain why we are subject to aberrant reinforcement behavior today, in the case of obesity, in the case of addiction, etc. Okay, finally, in the last really couple of minutes, I will illustrate two of the main line of research of my laboratory, which are centered around two main questions in reinforcement learning in humans. So the first question that we wanted to address is whether do we learn value, is whether or not we learn value in an objective manner. Okay, so this is the general question. And in particular, is whether or not we encode rewards and punishment in a relative or an absolute scale. And essentially, we want to test an equivalent of this very famous illusion in which the same size is perceived differently if the stimuli around us not the same. Or for example, in a reinforcement learning or in a reward domain, you know, if I am in Palermo, not the Buenos Aires neighborhood, but my own town in this example, and I have to choose between a crappy coffee and a cappuccino, of course, they're gonna pick a very good cappuccino, and you know the value of the coffee is gonna be very, very low. Then I take my car and I drive back sadly to Paris. Now you can see that I can have a choice between the same crappy coffee and a glass of water, but in this very dark situation, of course, the best option is the coffee. And the question is whether these two kinds of stimuli are going to be perceived the same. So they are the same exactly, but are going to be the remembered the same, etc. And more quantitatively is that we have a reinforcement learning task with A, B, and C, D are now transformed into reinforcement value. One is a choice between two positive rewards and the other is a choice between two negative rewards. And we wanted to see whether the value was more consistent with the absolute value encoding or there was some sign of relative value encoding. And the hallmark of this relative value encoding is that essentially the slightly negative option is preferred to the slightly positive one because it was previously associated with an even worse option. These are the results in this case. So we were able to show significantly irrational preferences after learning when we recreate new choice context, just because the value of the option, so at least this is the most parsimonious explanation, were learned in a relative way. So as in the perceptual illusion was a contrast effect. Another question which we are much interested in our lab is, do we learn more from positive or negative surprise, okay? So the idea is that, you know, we have this learning rate. The learning rate measure how much I update the value as a function of the prediction error. And we wanted to assess whether there was a positivity or a negativity bias. And the results was more consistent with a positivity or what is often called a good news effect. So, or optimistic bias, if I may say, in which essentially positive prediction error, positive surprise have a stronger impact on our belief, okay? People neglect a little bit the negative feedback, right? Like, yeah. And we think that this cognitive bias may explain some microscopic behavior. So for example, some kind of lack of behavioral flexibility or so-called status quo bias, the fact that people have an inertia, a choice inertia, they don't want to choose an option, can naturally arise from an asymmetry between a positive and a negative update. Because if whenever you got a positive reward, you think that this option is good, and then it takes you three times more negative feedback to change your mind, you will naturally stick to one option. And can also explain risk-taking and pathological gambling. So for example, when you buy this kind of ticket of the lottery, you have to scratch. There is few rate of positive rewards, but apparently this very few rate of positive rewards is sufficient to in certain people to generate a very strong habits, a very strong behavior. Okay, so thank you or gracias. Thank you very much for your attention. And I want to mention a few things. So first of all, in general, I want to thank, as always, my team that work very hard to provide all the nice, I hope you think nice results insight that I showed you. And so I don't know if there are someone that can be interested at some point, but I wanted to advertise that we have a very good master and graduate school here at École Normale in Paris. They are quite competitive, but the applications are open to everybody. So if you're interested in the topics, this one or the other ones which I presented, some of you may be interested in applying to this program.
Well, Stefano, can you hear me? Yeah. Okay, well, thank you very much for your talk. It is really amazing to know about your research. And also, it is important to highlight that this level of complexity and summarizing it in 40 minutes is quite impossible. So congratulations for that. So let's turn to the QA session. And the first question make me laugh quite a bit. And I'm going to read to you.
Yeah.
It says, do behaviorists and cognitive scientists fight in your country too? Or is something that has gone out of fashion?
So yeah, it's a very important question. I mean, could take the whole 10 minutes of remaining, but I will try to. So first of all, the historical problem is not with behaviorism per se, it's with what is called the radical behaviorism that actually was promoted by Skinner. Okay, so radical behaviorism is a very peculiar and extreme philosophy of psychology which essentially actively neglect any form of internal representation. But I hope that in my talk it was quite clear that we take essentially what is a cognitive approach to reinforcement learning behavior. Because for example, this value of the options is nothing else about an internal representation of the value of the option. So it's inherently cognitive model. Now, this being said, it is true that in my field and my own philosophy of science and psychology, I am what I can call a functional reductionist. So I will try to look for the simplest form of behavior and the simplest explanation of the behavior. So for example, many times when I debrief verbally my subjects, they will tell a lot of complex things about what the way they think they've done the task. And I totally think they believe that, but I'm essentially able to better predict than my own subjects how they're gonna behave in the task, because I think what they are really following as you may say unconscious or implicit learning rules that are cognitive, so that rely on internal representation. But the idea is that we still focus more on what can be defined action, motor, or explicit behavior rather than verbal reports in our field. But I think this is something that has been pushed by the behaviorist movement and has a lot of scientific merits, including the possibility of translating research between humans and animals, which otherwise is complicated to do.
Perfect. So we are going to pass to the next. Do you work on AI projects and prediction of moods and behavior? Do you have a bioethical position in this regard and in relation to transhumanism and human rights?
Well, the answer is not not really. We have some collaborations with some private company that try to, not with the AI part, but essentially to try to better understand the psychology of subjects to some extent to better improve the products that they have, etc. But I also have some projects that is more like purely theoretical. So may join AI research, but it's not, I would say we are not exposed to, at least yet, to the ethical problems, for example, concerning the utilization of AI in the profiling of the subject that can be then used for, you know, hiring people or something like that. But it's, yes, it's something that we should watch, of course, because of course each paper that you publish can be used or misused, etc. So we have to be very careful in communication and thinking about the research agenda also on these aspects.
Perfect. The third question, can you recommend researchers' bibliography? Would you recommend Kahneman's Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow? I know that you do recommend that, but maybe you can explain more than that.
Yes, so for example, for people that are interested in this case would be more the rise, the invention, you know, the promotion of behavioral economics. Thinking Fast and Slow is a very good book. Another book that I can advise for behavioral economics is Richard Thaler, Misbehaving. So Thaler is the Nobel Prize with the last behavioral economics Nobel Prize. The book is called Misbehaving. It's also quite interesting. Yes.
Perfect. Then, how can a real biological reward system be integrated in a reinforcement learning algorithm?
Yes, so it can, and for maybe simplification of time space, I omitted a huge field of research, which is essentially the neural network modeling of reinforcement learning. So there are very quite well-functioning models that are not just precisely, they take into account essentially the architecture of the cortex, the subcortex, the connection, etc., and instantiate reinforcement learning in a quite biological, plausible manner that also make a difference between neurotransmitter and neuromodulators, etc. But whether this is statistical more efficient than a deep neural network, I don't know. Probably not today, but there are attempts to try to have more really biologically inspired model of reinforcement learning that take into account essentially neuromodulation, which is a very important feature.
Perfect. Then we have a question that I had when I was doing your course, but you made the time to answer during the first class. Do you work in a transdisciplinary way?
Yeah, the answer is yes. So it's a matter of fact. The funny thing is they always work on the same topic, but I've been publishing in psychology, neuroscience, psychiatric and neurology journals. So this is why, because reinforcement learning is a very central topic, central to pathology, is central to psychology in general. So there is a fourth more transdisciplinary in terms of the methods. We've been using lesion, we've been using fMRI modeling. And now what we are trying to develop even further is to actually translate our own task to animal research. So to have a cross species comparison. We are also trying to develop a project that's even close to artificial intelligence on which we complexify the model and the simulation. And I would say so. And you can see the people in my team, they come from psychology, economics, robotics, mathematics, biology. So it's a really interdisciplinary field.
Perfect. Then how to avoid the biases of AI, which affect human behavior and life? A really huge question.
It's a huge question. And the simple way is, the problem of biases in AI, about which we discussed today, is a 90% problem of supervised learning, okay? That are the fact that the training set is often biased, is not representative of the whole population. So for example, the training set will be biased to detect some kind of information first than the others, etc. So we should make the training set more inclusive as possible. And then there is other problems that are not at the cannot be solved at the computational, the modeling level, that has to be solved at the ethical level, is to which extent we want to rely on this predictive device to actually inform decisions. Okay, so for example, let's take a very sensitive topic, is a random search at the airport, right? So if you take the histories of people making troubles in the airports, you will unfortunately find a very, you know, specific set of humans. Is it rational to search more frequently this specific set of humans just because in the past the history tells you that there are higher chance to put a bomb in a plane? Scientists cannot answer this question. Just not because we don't have the opinion about that, but just because there is the realm of science, which is the objectivity world, nature, and then there is the realm of ethics, and this is another playground.
Excellent. And a final question that I want to make: how one can go from being an undergrad student to become head of research team, as is your case? What is the usual path to become a researcher? So this is the last question.
Yes, this is let's say that the first easy answer is that there is no precise path. So the only several steps. So you first do your PhD, then you do a postdoc, and then you start apply for positions, etc. Within this traditional trajectory that I am sure the person that asked the question already know, so it's not the there are a very huge diversity of pathway. What I can say is that first of all, you have to find something that you really like, you are really motivated. So for example, I originally studied molecular biology. I was quite good at university, but I realized that I didn't want to work on that. So my actually first paper is a molecular biology paper. And I lost some time to change field, to move to cognitive neuroscience. But I think I gained this time 5 times later, because even if I took 2 years from my master to take the right PhD, it was the right PhD, and then I was very performant, etc. Other important thing is that you have to be resilient. So I had, thanks to my supervisor and also luck, a very successful, and I think also a good project, a very successful PhD. Yet I spent almost 1 year working for free, because essentially nobody seems to wanted to found to give me a grant for my PhD. But I was stubborn, I stick to the plan, and then I was rewarded at the end. And even today, you will see my own internet site, I show off all my success, grant this publication, this grant, this fellowship, everything is great. But there are almost 5 times more failures in my CV. So each time that I get a grant, I have to try 3 times, and everybody's the same. Each time I get a paper, I have to submit in 3 different journals. So you be resilient. You should have a positivity bias. You should forget about the failures and just remember the positive one. So by the way, this is probably what is the adaptive value of the positivity bias. Because if I start a project thinking that actually it's gonna take 5 years and it's gonna be rejected by nature as science, I will probably be less motivated starting the project. But then there is this optimistic bias, and the startup project think, this in 6 months is gonna be over, and they're gonna publish in Science, it's gonna be great. This is not the case, but the important thing is that in these 5 years, we actually learned a lot, and this is what should be, this is what is the reward at the end. And at some point, you don't even care anymore. So, yeah.
Well, these are excellent recommendations. Well, thank you very much, Stefano, for joining us today, since it is already 9:15 in the evening in Paris. We will let you go. So, thank you.
Thank you, Thomas.
Thank you again for
the invitation.
And thank you for collaborating this Science Dissemination Week. Bye-bye.